Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus Christ, my God, I adore you and I thank you for the many favors you have bestowed on me this day. I offer you my sleep and all the moments of this night, and I pray you to preserve me from sin. Therefore, I place myself in your most sacred side and under the mantle of our Blessed Lady, my Mother. May the holy angels assist me and keep me in peace, and may your blessing be upon me. Amen. In the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. So, I'm going to try and do two different things at once during tonight's class. So, it might not work, but we'll find out together. My assumption is that some of you are going to Mass most Sundays, but not everyone and not every Sunday. And even if you are, I can only imagine how odd it can be and feel, you know, if you've never gone. And I asked a friend of mine, I was like to her before the talk, and I said, if you could talk to a bunch of non-Catholics about what the Mass is, what would you tell them? And she goes, I would just tell them that we're not a cult. And I said, what? Like, all the things. Like, she's got, like, this amazing faith. And she was like, yeah, but, like, sometimes I just, like, walk in there and I'm sitting there going, I can only imagine what an outsider would think is everybody knows the response but me, right? Because it doesn't, like, most of these responses aren't, like, your average response, right? Like, nobody talks like this. I've never once out on the streets of La Plata and said, and with your spirit, unless I'm mocking somebody, mostly Father Larry. But, like, that's not, like, a way in which we talk. When we come to Mass, we lay ourselves aside, and we respond as a community. And that's part of what this is, that the Mass is three things at once, because it's all a grace, and so God can do more than we can. So it accomplishes three things all at the same time. It is primarily our mode of worship. It is our highest form of giving praise to God and thanksgiving to Him. It is among all the other things that we do, this is it. This is the work of the church, offering our thanks to God. And in that, it is both meal and sacrifice. And one of the things to remember as you come is you can kind of go too far in either way, and that's a mistake. To understand the Mass, you have to keep all three of these things in mind. One, I am worshiping God. Two, I am coming together for a meal in which Christ Himself is instituted. And three, I am participating in a sacrifice. And it is nothing less than the sacrifice of Christ on the cross, right? We call it the unbloody sacrifice of Christ. That this is it's a representation of the sacrifice of the cross. Now, why do we say it's that? Not because we do the exact same motions, right? But rather because the effect of the Mass is as strong as the crucifixion was. Why? Because the effect of the cross was because God Himself became man and then completely poured Himself out. It is a complete kenosis, is the Greek word. You may have heard it before. That is a complete laying out of Himself on the cross. And it's the same thing that happens here. That God, in the same way, completely condescends. Right? Not in the, you know, condescending tone, but in a condescending as in He comes down from heaven to be with us. That's why this is so powerful. That's the you know, base level understanding of why this sacrifice is so strong and why this worship is so powerful, why we proclaim it to be so important to keep to all of the things that we do. Before we jump into what the Mass looks like, you know, whether you've been or not, I just want to give kind of an overview from the first century. Okay, so there was one of the first catechisms in Christianity was called the Didache, the Teaching of the Twelve. And they have this outline of what their Sunday celebration was. And it says, and it starts, I guess it's now considered chapter 9. I don't know that it necessarily had like chapter headings like we would have in a formal book, but just bear with me. So with regard to the Eucharist, give thanks in this manner. First, over the cup. We give thanks to you, our Father, for the holy vine of David, your servant, which you revealed through Jesus, your servant. Then thanksgiving over the bread, right? And then we petition in a very similar way. And there's a very powerful witness to the way in which we think about the Eucharist in which the very early church thought of it. Let no one eat or drink of your Eucharist unless they have been baptized in the name of the Lord. For the Lord says in this regard, do not give holy things to dogs. That this is not just meant to be this as outreach moment, but rather this is a sign, not of this is for all, but rather this is part of the call. This is the meal portion. That the meal is a communitarian thing. It is, you have to be brought into this unity to be able to partake. So it starts with, before you can even come to the meal and the sacrifice and the worship, you have to be brought into the family, to be adopted in and what we say, incorporated, brought into the one body of Christ. And then we give thanks for God's past works, over the gifts, we petition for the church, and for all of mankind. That there's this very similar structure from the very beginning of the church to now. So, there are several things that we could go with. There's several ways we could kind of talk about how the Mass is the way it is. We could talk about the developments. We could talk about the differences and how the rites of the church. We could talk about how if you were, I don't know, there's not very many of them, but there are things called Eastern Rite churches, and the church itself looks very different, but it still has the same kind of basic structure in a certain sense. We could talk about all of the different ways. I want to kind of talk about the practicalities of some of these things, but how it points to these three elements of what the Mass is, of worship, meal, and sacrifice. But probably what comes out most strongly will be the sacrifice, right? Like, because that's everything about the structure of things comes together as a sacrifice, starting with what is the minister called? What is the presider called? But he's called priest, right? And priest has one purpose in his life. No matter what faith he has had, even in the pagan, whatever it would be, I guess it's not really a faith, but in pagan religions, the priest was there to offer sacrifice. And the high priest offered sacrifice once, and the other priest would offer it over and over again, right? And so there is, from the very beginning, just this sense of like, oh yeah, like this, we could have called the ministers in the church, the clergy, anything else. We could have kept it with presbyters or episcopoi, right, with the bishops, but we have this language very early on of these are priests. They're offering sacrifice because their role, right? We say the priest steps in persona Christi into the person of Christ to offer. Now, for most masses you go to, I would say some probably, unless you choose otherwise, 99.5% of masses you will go to for the rest of your life, most of the language will be English. Right? That most of the Mass will be in what we call the vernacular, in the tongue that you speak. So like, okay, if you go to Mexico, it'll be in Spanish, in France, it'll be in French, and et cetera, et cetera. But if you're here, you're going to hear the Mass in the language that you speak normally. But you'll also hear other languages being spoken. Not a lot, but enough. You'll hear the word Amen and Alleluia. These are Hebrew words. They're not English, and they're not Latin, which is the usually the main language in the Latin Church, but a Hebrew. So we have the Hebrew language sitting in it. There's a part, parts especially that we sing here at Sacred Heart in Latin, what we call the Sanctus, the Memorial Acclamation, a couple other times usually throughout, but so Latin, and then the third one is oftentimes, we'll get to when it happens, there's a part of the prayer called the Kyrie, which is Lord have mercy. And that's in Greek. Now why did I not just bring that up as they come? Well, because the language itself points to the sacrifice of the cross. Because those three languages are the same three languages that were over the sign. So the language that gets used in the Mass is pointing back to the cross. There's no reason for the Kyrie to exist, right, in the Mass. Like there's no reason to use Greek except for to have that allusion back to what was being offered. That this is a sign of what is out there. Same with Amen. Why didn't we translate that word? Why don't we just say I believe over and over again? Because we don't want to. We want to keep the fact that we are pointing back to this moment, this epitome of human existence. Well, maybe not the epitome, but pretty dang close. Maybe what is the most important moment in human history. So, how does Mass start? A Sunday Mass in most parishes will start not in the sanctuary, but outside, basically. So at the entrance of the church. And it started with a psalm. Right? Sometimes it's a simple chant from Scripture, but a lot of times it'll be a hymn. And the reason for that is if you look at Psalm 68, the singers coming in forefront, singers in the forefront, musicians bringing in the rear, right? At the beginning of the procession, there ought to be song, because this is both a joyous occasion, but it's also invoking Palm Sunday, right? The moment in which Christ enters into Jerusalem, Jerusalem being representing the church, right? That we're coming in to this moment of Christ is proclaimed with song as he walks in. But where does that lead but to his death? And it leads, and the death is understood only in context of Holy Thursday. So, we finish the song. The priest will walk in, and the first thing he does is reverence our Lord. He'll genuflect, unless he's physically unable. But almost always he genuflects down. And then he comes and he kisses, reverences the altar, right? To say this is how important this is, right? Because for Catholic theology, you're... The priest is Christ, the altar is Christ, so that he could produce Christ. Because Christ is himself both the victim and the fruit of the sacrifice, as well as the priest. So this is you don't get away from this moment. Because then that's only done because of his freedom. Okay. Sorry, I'm getting a little lost. And then we come and we pray together, drawing into the community in which we're baptized in. So we begin with the sign of the cross, and the priest will start, right? In the name of Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and the people respond, Amen. Now I'm going to pause for just a second, because if you don't normally go to Mass, you won't know the responses. And normally we would have a missal or a card in the little pew back things in front of you to try and help you out, but we're not allowed to right now, okay? But if you have your little brown book of Catholic prayers, it actually does have the Mass, and it's the correct translation. The reason you'll hear that is because it was like 10 years ago that we changed the translation of the Mass from the old Latin to English. And so if you want to follow along, it starts on page 39, right? And I'm just going to kind of walk through it rather quickly, but just to kind of understand the structure of what we're doing, right? So it begins with a calling together of the community of persons of God. We call together the community in the same name, okay? And then the priest, I actually really appreciate this part of the Mass. The first thing he does is he greets the people in one of three ways. I almost always, because I refuse to memorize the other greetings, I almost always say, the Lord be with you, okay? And the response is, and with your spirit. But that's like a bizarre thing to say to somebody. And that's on purpose, right? Like this isn't anything else. This is truly a sacred time. It is a holy time. It is set apart from any other moment. I talk to people very differently from the pulpit than I do outside of church, right? Like, and I should. Right? This should be a different moment than the rest of the day, right? Because this is an act of worship, and because we're not focused on one another, even when we greet one another, but we're brought into the person of God. Like, this is not just a community meal or even a sacrifice in which I am the priest, but it's also a worship of God as its primary purpose, right? So that's why we have this unique greeting, you know, that we use when we come to worship God. And then we're immediately called to call to mind our sins. Because this isn't the same as confession, which we'll talk about next week. But this is a moment in which sins are venial sins are kind of wiped away to an extent, right? Like they're pushed out just gently enough, just the little ones. But it's also a reminder of our unworthiness, which is a strange spot to sit in for a second. It's not very long, but it's enough to just say, oh yeah, I am wildly unworthy of what I'm about to do. But yet, you're making me worthy, aren't you, Lord? You're calling me to something greater. You've called me to take part in this community. You've called for me to be part of your family. You're called to me to see this sacrifice. And so we pray, we name our prayers almost always with the first name of the prayer. So the one you'll hear most Sundays, especially here, is called the Confiteor. Now the prayer is in English, but the words I confess in Latin are Confiteor. Okay? So it's I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters. That there is a sense in which our faith, it's right away we're reminding ourselves that our faith is not individualistic. It's not ours. It's not for me to change. But rather, confessing to God, I know that I'm also sinning against my brother always, okay? And there's a part where, you know, if you've ever heard the term mea culpa, right? That's my fault, all right? So through my most grievous fault. And you beat your breast, right? And you're not supposed to hurt yourself over it, but, you know, hit yourself. You know, it's calling to mind the sinful man in Luke chapter 18, right? Who wouldn't even look up in the heavens, look up at the Father, but rather kept his eyes downcast, beat his breast, have mercy on me, a sinner. Right? Why? Because we're like that is a very penitential act, right? I don't get really excited and I'm like, yes. I mean, I guess some people do that, but that's kind of weird, right? That like you kind of just you're reminding yourself. Because it's not that God needs us to hit our breast, right? That the sacramental nature of this is that we're reminding ourselves of all this stuff, right? We don't, you know, God doesn't even need our worship. We need to worship Him, right? All of these things that we do aren't because God gets angry if we don't. He's pretty content without us, but He loves us enough to call us to Himself. So when we think of like all these little actions we're doing, we're like, well, that seems silly, but it's like, but it does help you. It helps remind you. Actually, okay, so if you ever pray, at the end of the rosary, there's a prayer called the Salve Regina, the Hail Holy Queen. And this is just a cute aside, it has nothing to do with the Mass, okay? But traditionally, you would say, O Clement, O Loving, O Sweet Virgin Mary, and you would beat your breast three times, right? And it's just one of those things that I don't know. I've done it since I was 5 years old because I watched my mother do it, right? But my little brother has a 2-year-old daughter, and they pray a rosary together every night, he and his wife, and she has to stay in the room. Now, I watched this video. She's not praying the rosary, okay? He told me she was. She's not praying the rosary. She's playing with her dolls in the corner, okay? But all of a sudden, they start the Hail Holy Queen, and she drops her dolls. She runs over, and she gets really excited. And I've like, she's a happy girl, but this was like a really overly genuine like excitement. And all of a sudden they go, oh Clement, oh Loving, and she gets real excited and she's like, I got this. Like, and she didn't. She missed her chest because, I don't know, she's very unathletic. But it's really kind of cute. That, like, don't do that. So hit your breast. All right. So that part is called the penitential act. And then we pray this Lord have mercy. So we sometimes say it in English, sometimes in the Greek. Kyrie eleison. Christe eleison. Kyrie eleison. It's just one of these things that we're calling to mind who we're coming in front of. We're bringing ourselves into the proper disposition of what we're entering into. Right? This isn't a wedding feast, but it's a meal that leads to a sacrifice. Right? That it's a God who speaks quietly in the earth. So we don't want to distract ourselves with some goofiness like a priest talking about his 2-year-old niece, right? Oftentimes on Sundays, but not every Sunday. Throughout most of the year, on Sundays, you'll hear the Gloria. We sing it, the Gloria be the glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill, right? Echoing that song of the angels at the Nativity. That this is used anytime you see the priest in green or white. That's going to be on Sundays, okay? Or Saturday evening. Like, you'll know you're going to be singing it. When you see him in purple, he won't sing the Gloria. Because those are penitential or preparatory seasons of Advent or Lent. Those times right before Christmas and Easter, okay? I know, and I'm going through fast, but it's okay. Then the priest will call us all together to pray. He says, let us pray. And then offers a prayer to God. That changes week to week, but it's meant to be a connecting to what we're called to pray about in that day. Sometimes you'll hear about it in the homilies, most of the time you won't. But that changes every Sunday. So that part won't be in your little book, but there are apps like iBreviary or Laudate, both of which you can actually see these. These aren't like secret, obviously, because we're saying them out loud. Call to mind. These are called the introductory rites. This is just how we start, all right? And we're standing the whole time. Then, right at the end of that, the people respond, amen. I believe everything that has just happened. I believe this is a good introduction to what I'm about to occur. And we sit for the readings. Now, except for Easter, the structure of the readings go just like this. Old Testament reading, a responsorial psalm that is almost always sung, a second reading, which is always from the New Testament, usually from one of Paul's letters, but also any of the other epistles or the Acts of the Apostles. And then a gospel acclamation, which is the Alleluia, followed lastly by the gospel itself. So, during Easter, that first reading gets replaced by Acts of the Apostles. Why? Because we're celebrating the church, this new-founded church, and what is the Acts of the Apostles, if not the story of the early church, okay? So, for the readings, the end of that reading, and this is me trying to remember that it's not the norm, but the lector, the layperson who's at the lector will say, "The word of the Lord," and everyone responds, "Thanks be to God." Why? Because it's an understanding that that what is happening, that God is showing himself in the reading, right? Not in a visible sense, but auditory, that we can hear and then understand that he is showing himself to us, and we should be grateful for this action, for this free gift that he has offered up, all right? So, then you'll often see if there's a deacon, the priest will... All right, we sit for the readings. Everyone stands for the Alleluia. And you'll see a deacon receive a blessing from the priest. And he'll bow down and say, "Your blessing, Father. May the Lord be in your heart and on your lips and proclaim his gospel worthily and well. May the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen." Is the prayer that's offered to him. Not everybody knows that, but you do know. If the priest doesn't have a deacon, he'll come around and he proclaims the gospel. So this is just showing the reverence that we offer to the gospel. The gospel itself, as these words are so holy and so salvific that we add a little bit more reverence by changing our physical position. And so we stand up again. All right? And so this, if he has to proclaim the gospel himself, he bows down in front of the, kind of lines himself up in the middle of the altar, facing the crucifix and the tabernacle, he bows down and says, "Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, that I may proclaim your holy gospel." This comes from Isaiah chapter 6. It's not the full thing that happens, but there's a really kind of a, kind of this purgation that happens in Isaiah chapter 6, where Isaiah's like, "I'm not good to be a prophet. I don't know if you know me, God," which is always kind of a funny thing to say, but he's like, "I don't know if you know who I am, but I'm pretty sinful." And he goes, "Don't worry, I got you." And he has one of his angels grab a coal out of the holy fire and put it to his lips, right? We don't have to do all that. But that's kind of that's what we're doing, is we're asking for that same, don't let the words of my mouth fall upon empty ears, because I'm not worthy to say these words. Right? But that's what we're doing in that brief moment. Priest or deacon finishes the gospel. He says, "The gospel of the Lord." The people respond, "Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ." And then the priest or deacon will kiss the gospel, book of the gospel, and said, "Through the words that are spoken..." I don't know, what does it say in English? I actually only know it in Latin. Through the words that are spoken, I don't know, "Pure Evangelii Dicta Delianta Nostra Delicta." Through the words that are spoken is our delight. And then either the deacon or more often than not, the priest gives a homily. So the homily, we use the term homily and not sermon. For a very particular reason. A homily is kind of like, in a sense, a subset of a sermon. So a sermon is just a religious talk on something. But I get to pick the topic. Like, I'm in charge of what gets said. We don't get to do that. We're bound to what is said. We don't pick the readings every week. In fact, just to show you, this is our, what's called the lectionary. This is from the readings from... that we use during the Mass. This is just our weekday lectionary, okay? There's a separate one for the Sundays, okay? Because we do it, those are on 3-year cycles, these are on 2-year cycles, and it's given every single day of the year. And so we have very little say in what we're about to preach on Sunday, and which is both freeing, because we're offering something good to God, and but it also means that we don't give sermons, we give homilies. Because homily means that it's just bound to the reading that is given. So, yeah. Yeah, yeah. So that whole explanation of the readings. Not for the homily, but for the readings themselves. Those are predetermined. You could literally look up any day of the year in 2050, and they'll tell you pretty much this is what the plan is. It could technically change, but it doesn't usually. It rotates. Yeah.
But they don't use every Catholic church.
Every Catholic church.
Huh? Will be your own name,
but
the liturgy.
Yep. You go here, you go to St. Peter's in New York, you go to St. Patrick's in New York, you go to St. Peter's in Rome, you go to, Our Lady of Guadalupe in Mexico. The language might be different, but the readings are the exact same. The homily will be definitely different. I mean, the homily between me and Father Larry is different week to week, including sometimes even the topic itself. But it's all based on the same readings.
And
I mean, if you want to keep it, you know, we're just not allowed to leave it in the pew. Yeah. One day they will come back, but not this day. Yeah. All right. Then the priest finishes, or the deacon finishes his homily. Usually sits down for a minute, and then everyone stands to proclaim, to make the profession of faith. This is the Nicene Creed. This is every Christian throughout the world proclaims the same creed. This is ancient. I mean, we're talking, 1,700 years, basically, at this point, of this is the basic tenets of the faith. Now, sometimes we'll use the Apostles' Creed, but for the most part, it's this one. It's the same thing that is proclaimed, maybe sometimes not always understood the exact same way, but... and then we offer the prayers of the faithful. Okay? And the priest introduces it, and then oftentimes it's the deacon who... will actually say the petitions. And there's kind of a cool theological reason for that, is that the priest, the priest is the priest. He stands in the person of Christ. He brings the prayers through his attentiveness to the Father. But the deacon is meant to be kind of a halfway point. He's meant to be a servant on the behalf of the priest for the sake of the people. So he should be attentive to the needs of the people. So in theory, he should know what he should be saying for the prayers of the faithful. Now at this point, this is the first half of the Mass. Now this used to be called the Mass of the Catechumens. So we say Mass, it's the whole thing, but it's actually two different things. Okay, I know it sounds funny, but I promise you it makes sense. All right, so this was the part in which everybody could participate. There used to be a dismissal here. There used to be a part where it was kind of a, okay, from everything you've heard up until now, that's for everybody to know. But this next part is so sacred. This celebration of the Eucharist is so sacred that it's only ready for those who are baptized. And so I think even within in the RCIA process, when it comes closer to Easter, there's going to be a dismissal at this point of the Mass, after the prayers of the faithful. For you, and it's usually meant to be a time for greater catechesis and et cetera. But it's just kind of a remembrance that this is a big jump, and so again, that's why often there's a chant or a song at this point, is because there's a whole new liturgy about to take place, a whole new work of the people worshiping God. That's kind of like turning up the volume to the next level, right? Everything we've done has been worship the whole time, but this is the higher worship. This is the perfect worship where it's no longer about us at all. It's not about me teaching. It's not about me exhorting. It's not about you hearing and being fed. It is about you being fed, but just in a different way. It's not about your intellect anymore. This is about the moment of faith that's about to occur, done by the hands of the priest. And so he prepares the gifts using words. Now, oftentimes on Sunday you won't hear these preparatory prayers because there is singing. So he says these very quietly. But if you come on a weekday to Mass, which I encourage, you'll hear him say these prayers over the gifts. And it's kind of this very he'll receive the bread and he says, "Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever." Right? And this is a familiar prayer. This would be an old Jewish prayer of offering, right? Before the Seder meal, right? And so and then again, he does the same thing with the wine, slightly different. "Blessed be you, Lord, God of all creation. For your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever." Right? Now, at that moment, then, the priest bows low, and he offers a simple prayer. "With humble spirit and contrite heart, may we be accepted by you, O Lord, and may our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God." This comes from Daniel chapter 3. It's just an old purification prayer to say, like, okay, I'm not really worthy. Like, the priest constantly is reminding himself, I'm not really worthy to be doing this. Not really a good in persona Christi, but you've made me worthy. I didn't earn it, but you gave it to me. And so in this moment, he's reminding himself again, who am I to be able to do this? But for the sake of God, I will. And then he washes his hands. Now, all right, we'll just pause. We're going to put a pin in incense for a second. And then he washes his hands. "Wash me, Lord, from my iniquities. Cleanse me of all my sin." All right? Now, at this moment, if you go to most Catholic churches in the United States, you will see, oftentimes the priest will stand, if this was our church, he would stand between the altar and the tabernacle. All right? So kind of behind the candles. And he would face in a direction called versus populum, all right? Which means towards the people. Now, traditionally, so we're talking the first 1950 years of Catholicism, the priest and the people faced the same way, and it was called ad oriental, which meant towards the east. Now, it didn't mean literally east, as you can tell from our church, because east is that way, okay? If you didn't know, east is that way. But it's liturgical east. It's towards the rising sun, right? Now, in English, it's an awesome pun, okay? That it's both east is where the sun rises, but it's also the rising sun, who is Jesus Christ, in the flesh. So, why do we see it here? Now, it was done when I was... This is something that is done here before I got here, but it's awesome. It is, I think, a more spiritually profound way. I very rarely saw it as a lay person, but as a priest, I always prefer it. When I celebrate Mass in my mother's kitchen, I will celebrate it facing the same direction as her. And there's a reason for it. I kind of had to explain it to her. I explain it to anybody who wants to know that, like, this is the most proper direction. It's the only thing that makes sense. I hate the distractions that come from looking at, but that doesn't even really matter. That's on me. I got to handle the distractions, but it makes the most sense for who I am. Because when I face towards you, I have to put on a show. You begin to see every one of my facial expressions, you know, and I got a lot of little twitches that people kind of know, and especially like when a baby kind of laughs on the side, I kind of smile too, right? And everyone's like, "Oh, that's so cute. Father cares," you know? It's like, no, don't worry about that right now. I'm about to make Christ on the cross. Like, this is huge. But like, that's not very important. But rather, it reminds us that, like, my role is to stand before the Father for your sake. When I stand on the other side of that, I stand between you and Jesus. And I'm saying, like, it's almost like, hey, I'm God, and I am offering this prayer for you, right? And I hate that feeling. I think it's just so silly of a direction. But even more than that, for a celibate priest, you know, unmarried, you know, and, you know, ideally chaste, right? Like, we, this is the most intimate thing we do. Like, I think more than anything else, like, this is something that, like, is lost. Is in this moment, like, I am united to my bride in a way more profound than any other time, right? More profound than the confessional, more profound than during the homily or during any pastoral counseling, more than anything else I do. In this moment, it is why I laid down my life. I offended a good friend of mine one time because she was a parishioner, and she was like, why did you become a priest? I don't know how the conversation came up, but I was like, I didn't become a priest because of you. And she was like, Father, that's really rude. I was like, first off, I just met you, right? Like, I didn't meet you till I became a priest. I said, I became a priest because of God, right? Because he called me to this. And like, in this moment of the Mass, I'm in that moment. I would never think it appropriate to ask to sit in your bedroom, right? To sit and watch. But I do want to see the fruit, right? Like, I want to see your kids. Like, they're really great. And I want to participate in the joy that comes out of that. But I don't think it's appropriate for me to just watch your acts to be able to participate in the fruit of it, right? In this moment, like, that's part of this privacy, is that it's like, oh yeah, this is an amazing moment in which God comes to earth. And I don't need to see it for it to be real and to experience the great effects of what happens. So, in pastoral prudence, we want you to pray better. We want you to know what's happening more clearly. And so we pray together in the same direction. Okay? But that means that the priest at this point will turn around and invite you to join in prayers. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. And as one person reminded me recently, that's the priest turning around and throwing open the gates of heaven. Right? Like he, and it's not really what we're doing, technically, I guess, but it's like I'm turning around, moving from the altar and inviting you into this moment in a different but yet united way. My sacrifice and yours. It's not the same sacrifice, but it is united. And so all of your prayers come in to this great moment of union of God and man in the world. And then he prays again. He offers a prayer that's unique to each day. And then you'll hear this dialogue. And I always sing it. I'm not singing it tonight. But and I think Father Larry sings it most of the time. But it's the Lord be with you and with your spirit. And then there's a command. And it's a little bit lost in English. It sounds more gentle than it is in Latin. But it's lift up your hearts. But sorsum corda is kind of rude language. You know, it's like, hey, get out of yourself, right? We're going to heaven. And the people respond, we lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. And then the priest offers a preface. Now, this is where there's a few choices, all right? On Sunday, during ordinary time, there are 8 different prefaces. During Christmas, there are 3. During Easter, I think there are 5. During Lent, there are 4. So like you'll hear a different one from time to time. Right? And during the week, there's another 10 or so. So you hear that the exact words are different, but they all have a very similar beginning and almost an exact same end. That it is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Right? That's the start of this prayer of the Eucharistic celebration. And then ends with a uniting to all of the saints and angels. And that kind of changes a little bit from time to time. Sometimes the angels, the different choirs of angels are listed. So angels, archangels, thrones, dominations, principalities, powers, heavenly virtues, right? You'll hear them called by name, but sometimes it's just all the angels and saints. We declare your glory, and with one voice we proclaim. So we're uniting our prayers. This is a big thing, is during the Mass, during this moment of worship, meal, and sacrifice, we are uniting heaven and earth. And so how is that done? But through the angels. And so we're uniting. And all the saints are invited into that same moment. Right? There actually used to be a moment in which the priest would call together. Like, and he would pray like that a couple of times throughout the Mass. And they proclaim what's called the Sanctus, which is the Holy, 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 Lord God of Hosts, which is almost word for word with Isaiah 6. Okay? And then he says the prayer. Now, if you only come on Sunday, which is good, you most likely hear what's called the Roman Canon, the Eucharistic Prayer 1. But there are 4 options, okay, normally. Don't worry about the real particular differences. If this was a liturgy class, you would have to know the differences, but you don't. But basically, the direction is to the Father. The prayer is given to the Father, but it invokes, obviously, the Son and the Spirit. Why? Because we never get away from that. Right? The Trinity doesn't separate himself. But we start with, to you, Almighty Father. Or to you, most merciful Father, I'm sorry. In Eucharistic Prayer 1. And... oh, thank you. And we're a little long, so I won't go through the whole thing. But basically, we ask the Father to hear us, and then we pray for the church. Right? It's our first duty, right? Is to pray for the church. And like we kind of do this thing where we kind of come down and then bounce back out a little bit. Okay, so we start with the church and bring it in terms of the Holy Father, and then we bring it to the bishop, and then sometimes we'll even pray for the clergy, right? And then we pray for all of the living, right? So we're kind of doing this thing where we're reminding. Now, there's even a moment of silence. So oftentimes you'll hear, "Remember, Lord, your servants." If the intention from the Mass is for a living person, the priest will say it, or at least say it in his head. This is a good time for you to call to mind all the people who you know in the world right now, right? There's a time later in the Mass for the deceased, but this first silence should be for those who are still living. And then we pray for all gathered here, whose faith and notion in you, okay, et cetera, et cetera. And then you'll hear this litany of saints, this first litany that kind of comes out. And you'll notice a pattern in it, okay? So we start with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Ever Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul. So these are the two founding apostles of Rome. And then Andrew, who was the first apostle, who calls him Peter, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude. The rest of the apostles, okay? Then you'll hear Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius. These are popes. So there's kind of this cool moment where it's like, okay, right, the church is founded on the apostles, and immediately it moves to the pope, right? Like that he is the vicar of Christ. Like that's his role, is to keep Christ present in the world. Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian. These are martyrs in the Roman church. So this is why it's often called the Roman canon. It's because most of these saints, not the apostles obviously, but most of these saints died in Rome. Then this prayer called the Hanky Jesuit, which is kind of like, if you're not listening, or like if you listen really carefully, you're like, whoa, I didn't even know you could say these words during Mass. But like, it's really important. It says, graciously accept this oblation of our service out of your whole family. Order our days in your peace. So there's this order, which is not a word we like in modern society. Command that we be delivered from eternal damnation. Right? We're not even aiming high yet. Like, we're not like, show us your face. Let us live in eternal beatitude. We're just like, can we just not be damned for all time? Like, can we just get like that far along in here, right? But we build up from there, right? And count it among the flock of those you have chosen. Now this is, you'll always see what's called the epiclesis. And you'll notice, you won't be able to see it if it's at Oriental, but you'll hear a bell, usually, like, unless the server forgets. And he places his hands, the priest puts his hands flat over the gifts. So at this point, the it's still bread and wine. Right up in, through this prayer. If there isn't a tabernacle in here, you wouldn't genuflect if you had to walk by. You can kind of give a bow or something, but you're calling on, the priest is calling down the Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts. And he'll say these words or something similar. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. All right? And then we use the words of institution. Everything else, the priest is not supposed to change. But if he does, not the end of the world, right? Your Mass was good, right? If the priest went up there and called the Pope Benedict, well, that's probably problematic, but for a different reason. But if, like, he just kind of, like, messes up and he's a little lazy and he slurs his words or whatever, and you're just like, it's not a big deal. But these words are vitally important. Because it's not about the priest at all. It hasn't been. He can't do it on his own. But he uses these very particular words. And in them, assuming the bread is real bread, and the wine is real wine, and that he is a real priest, doesn't matter how holy he is or not holy he is, Jesus will show up under the auspices of bread and wine. And he says, the key words are, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. And then you'll hear a pause, a ringing of the bells, and the priest will hold the Eucharist, because now it's the Eucharist. Now it's it. Everything has changed Transubstantiation has occurred, right? That change of substance from bread into the flesh. Heaven and earth have met in a very profound way, that everything has changed. And he shows it just for a minute. Now, the history of adoration, from what I've heard, is that because you can't see what's going on the altar, you can't see the Eucharist through most of the Mass, except for this moment of consecration, that there was a piety that like, I always imagine this, I don't know this is how it worked out, but my guess is that the little old ladies started coming up to the priest and they said, "Father, we just want to see Jesus for a little bit longer. Can you hold him up a little bit longer?" And he goes, "Okay." And so instead of like 10 seconds, he put it up for 30. And they're like, "Father, like, that's our only chance to see Jesus. Can you hold him up a little bit longer?" And then the next week he's like, "All right, fine." And then he's sitting there and he's going, and he's like, for like a full minute. Now here's the thing. It doesn't seem that tiring. But like, hold your hands over your head. You're going to get tired pretty quick. It doesn't take that much effort. But it's still, for some reason, you're like, "Man, my shoulders burn. I don't get what's going on." And so I just think there's got to be a time where a priest just said, "You know what, I'm putting this in something else, and you can look at it all day if you want," right? And so that's where this monstrance, which just means to show, develops out of, is this moment of consecration of the Mass, and is now extended, which is not weird. If we understand how God works, right? God's time is so much different than ours that it doesn't seem strange at all to me that he would allow us for an opportunity to extend this great moment longer than even what we physically should be able to do. That he would allow himself to be seen in the monstrance in such a way. And then the priest similarly will offer the consecration over the wine. "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." This is, and then he holds it up and you'll hear the bells again. This is where I think the sacrifice is probably most clearly seen, right? A covenant is always ratified in a sacrifice. But it's, and the forgiveness of sins only comes through sacrifice, right? In the Jewish sense of how this worked, right? You offered a sacrifice for the forgiveness of sins. If you think back to your Old Testament theology, all right, the Passover meal was a moment of making a remembrance of what was to come, a leading through of the people out of the slavery in Egypt, through the waters, into the promised land eventually. That there was this moment, but that Passover meal continues for all eternity. It's still done to this very day, once a year. Now, our covenant can be renewed more frequently, but that's the understanding, is that it is both a sacrifice that was done once, but it's a meal that continues, that brings forth the fruit of that first sacrifice over and over and over again. Okay? Now, then there's kind of this, it's almost a catechesis moment of like, what are we doing? So therefore, as we celebrate, we're bringing to life, not celebrate like a child's birthday party, but celebrate as in bring to life the memorial of the Passion, Resurrection, and Ascension, right? And there's three Old Testament figures that are called out in the Eucharistic prayer. Abraham, Melchizedek. Abel, right? Offering the first fruits and the greatest of his sacrifices, holding nothing back, even though it cost him his life. Don't think that's an accident, right? The second would be Abraham, who was willing to offer even his very son in faith. That we're supposed to do the same thing. We're supposed to be willing to let go of everything that we hold dear in the world, everything we've been begging for our entire life for the sake of union with God. And Melchizedek, this king yet priest that we've been baptized in to do the same thing, right? These three characters are not just accidental, but rather really signify the greatness of what we're about to do. All right? And then we'll skip up to the commemoration of the dead. "Remember, Lord, your servants." And this is where we pray for the ones who have gone before us, right? Pray that they are released from purgatory and into heaven. Pray, for the repose of their soul. Now, and then we pray, "Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace." Right? We're praying for heaven. That's what heaven is at its core. And then the priest will have brought his hands together and he'll say, to us also your servants, who those sinners. And he'll beat his chest. Now, before the reforms of our Catholic liturgy in the 1960s, the whole prayer was done in pretty much dead silence. Right? Like nobody heard it. Like the server who was 5 feet away was not meant to hear the prayer. He could hear the voice, but not the words. But then at this moment, in the middle of all of these things in which the priest has been acting in persona Christi, in which he has been offering this prayer to the Father, as Christ, right now he says to us also your servants, right? He almost steps out of the person of Christ to remind himself of his humility. Those sinners, right? So this is kind of important. And then we bring in our second litany of saints, list of saints, to which we're asking to share some fellowship. So, John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints, right? I think without fail, these are all martyrs, right? You kind of look up each one of them. I remember, I'll skip that story. But basically, when you start hearing the second list, you can kind of begin to breathe a little bit because we're about to finish, right? There's this sense of like, we bring together this moment through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us, right? There's actually a real profundity there. Like, it's worth taking this prayer, this prayer of the church, to prayer. And then through him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and power is yours, now and forever. So, I don't know about this. I think I lost. Then, at this point, the whole Eucharistic prayer is done while kneeling, right? But then the next part is called the communion rite. Now, this is where the meal comes back into play. Because what do you do before meals? You pray. You offer grace. What is the prayer of grace for church? It's the Our Father. And so the priest calls us together. Through the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray, and then all together, Our Father who art in heaven, right? Now, where does the Our Father come from? The gospel. What do we do to show reverence to the words of the gospel? We stand up. And so everyone stands at the end of the great amen. And then the priest offers a prayer, kind of a small prayer of deliverance. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, etc., etc., as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ, right? Reminding ourselves we're transitory. We're looking towards something greater. And then the people respond with the doxology, for the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Yes?
The Our Father.
Yes.
Why is it we dare to
pray? Because, well, it's pretty... We're used to calling God Father, right? Because we're just like, that's the nature of God. That's not really true in most religions outside of Christianity. In any religion outside of Christianity, or maybe Judaism, but not really, right? That there's a newness in the relationship that's being established. And so the audacity to call somebody a father is like, this is how close we are, right? That, like, to the pagans, they would not have understood that. You know, even Muslims today, like, they would not... consider, they, you know, that's one of the great differences is what we refer to the God as, right? We say Abba, they say Allah. He's their master, he's our father, right? So there's just a difference in understanding our dignity before. So it's just kind of a reminder of that. Of course, we do it because Christ allows us to. All right, then we offer the sign of peace. COVID, we don't actually do it. Now you hear a very familiar gospel passage, right? Lamb of God takes away the sins of the world. We're looking at what John the Baptist is offering, right? Now, what's the cool thing about John the Baptist is that he says, behold the Lamb of God, which is what the priest will end up saying eventually, right? Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Now, if you know your scripture inside and out, which none of us do, but if you know it pretty well, you'll know that Abraham's sacrifice was unfulfilled, right? Where is the lamb that God, where is the lamb for the sacrifice? Isaac asks Abraham. And God says, or Abraham says, God will provide, right? And he puts Isaac on the thing, he doesn't do it. What does he sacrifice? A ram, right? That sacrifice is unfulfilled. And there's never a Lamb of God again spoken of until John the Baptist points to Jesus as he comes over the hill. Behold the Lamb of God. This is the fulfillment of everything we've been waiting for in faith. That's why we use his words there. And then we respond with the words of the centurion, right? This perfection of the covenantal people and the people who are outside it yet brought in because of our faith. And he says, Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. And then he says, but only say the words, my servant shall be healed. We say, but only say the words, and my soul shall be healed. All right? Communion is distributed. Priest says, the body of Christ. We respond, amen. And then purifies the vessels. Now, we tend to take very, very clear care because of what the Eucharist is. We spend time. Literally, my mom says when she was a kid, she used to try to mimic priest in this. When she would like scrape off the top of a can of tomatoes, because a priest usually does it in a very particular way. But we take care to make sure that we get every crumb, right, every scruple off of the Eucharist, off of our paten, so that we can consume it, right, so that there's nothing left. Just hanging around. Then the priest will pray, call us to prayer one more time together. Oftentimes it's kind of a marching order. It's very similar prayer almost every time. Lord, you have fed us with this sacrament. May it allow us to come to full charity. That's not what it ever says, but it's pretty darn close pretty much every time. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Then he offers a final prayer. And again he greets, the Lord be with you and with your spirit. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And there's a dismissal. Changes, there's a couple of options, but basically it's go in peace. Thanks be to God. What are we thanking him for in this moment? Not just everything that has occurred, which we are, but also thanking God for the mission that he has called us to. This go in peace, go glorifying the Lord by your life, go and proclaim the gospel of the Lord. All of these are things we should be grateful for because they are a sign of God's trust in us, and it's a sign of what we have been called to do as disciples and apostles of Christ. And then the priest is the first, to leave under a hymn. And then Mass ends. Now I'm going to add just one option that you won't see often, but you will see at high feast days, and that's the incense. And incense is used 4 or 5 times throughout the Mass. And it's kind of like the highlight. So it's at the beginning procession, the gospel as it's proclaimed, the gifts as they are prepared around the altar, at the consecration, and at the end. Now, incense has a couple of purposes. Incense is the smoke that we saw during benediction, right? And it has, I would say, two big things. The one is the smell. The smell is unique. You're not going to have a perfume with that smell. It's a sacred smell. And smell has a very powerful memory to it, right? And I think that's part of it, is that it captures us as part of what we're doing. We're being raptured into the greatness of encountering God. But the other one that I think you see when it's done really well is there's a haze in the church. It's reminding us of the mystery that's taking place, right? We get a little too comfortable seeing everything, right? We want to be like, oh no, God's present here, so I got to be able to see something. No. There's a mystery around what's happening. It's not bad. Mystery's not something to be afraid of. It's just a reality that we're entering into. So, just in case you ever see incense, I think it's one of the most. I like using it because I think it's a very profound addition to how we ought to pray. Now, I want to take a time to encourage. This is something that is oftentimes you'll see the second Mass is over. Everybody kind of wants to run to their car, right? And it's just like a common problem, or they got to go greet Father before everybody else does. I don't know why anybody wants to talk to me, but they do. And so but in this moment, right, Mass kind of ends quickly, right? The Eucharist, the distribution of communion, is only 5 minutes before the end of Mass. It really kind of crescendos and then drops real quick, right? So did that piece of bread still inside you? Right? You're still holding on to, he's in your stomach, but it's still there, very much physically. This is a good time to pray. This is a good time to what we call make an act of thanksgiving. For God, you showed up to meet me. God, you're completely united to me. Let me hear your voice a little bit more clearly, right? I just want to kind of recommend. You probably won't see it terribly often, but you will see it in probably the most peaceful people, of just making a really brief act of thanksgiving at the end of Mass, rather than jumping into the rest of the world, including your neighbors who you love, and that's why you're here, right? Is that there's a sense in which we got a real good opportunity to come close. You know, God has come close to us. We might as well take the time to get close to Him more profoundly in these moments. All right, let's pray and then take questions. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, you have called us by name. You have called us closer to you, and you have come closer to us. May we always be aware of your presence, especially in the most blessed sacrament. May we know your love and care as we worship you in the Mass. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.